Okay, so looks like we had to restart the show. Peter, are you in here now?
I am in here now.
Okay.
Is this a new hangout?
This is a new one. I'm gonna post links everywhere. So.
Okay.
I don't know if the connection got locked, or maybe it was on my end, but sorry if it was.
Happens. I've never seen, like, you know, the Hangout say technical issues. And
yeah, that's what happened when I went to my site and turned it on. So. Anyway. Oops. Oh, I can't throw a link in the comments. I guess that kind of sucks.
Yeah,
you can really comment on the old one. So,
well, just say, you know, we posted a new one in Artcast, so we can put the link there.
Yeah, I'll run over there. I'll do that real quick. So,
well, hi everybody.
There you go. Like, yeah, and I even got it like embedded on my site and everything, so now nobody can watch it as they're there. We're riding in here real quick. So anyway, what happened was the old show got messed up. We had to start a new show, so all the links were wrong. I'm going to take a minute and just update everybody's links.
Yes.
I want a pain in the neck. I notice it's like all of my, seems like all of my, you know, social media just seems to be Facebook anymore. You know? I really noticed that like everything I do is just like post on YouTube and post on Facebook. And it's kind of weird. You know what I mean? It's really shrunk down. And I worry that Facebook is just going to screw me at some point and really tighten it down even more than they already do. And
I don't know. I don't, you know, I kind of feel like they won't go too far because they'd just be screwing themselves.
Yeah.
You know, it's a billion-dollar company. If people start getting, you know, disillusioned.
Right. Yeah. But I don't know, you know, it's just like, I mean, the internet, you know, it's like there's so much stuff that's not always perfect. And big companies go out of business and are replaced by, you know, new ones. And I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, you know, kind of, it might not be around forever, but it is the one we have now. And,
yeah.
I know, like, people are always looking for new things, but there's nothing quite like Facebook at the moment.
No, it's actually, all right, sorry, the show sucks so far, but I had to start. Come on. Can't post the link, but I imagine they'll find it. They probably came from Facebook anyways. Yeah, okay. So I guess that's good enough for now. Yeah, what a pain.
Yeah,
we did this,
you know, like I said,
another time.
I never saw that happen quite like that. So
I wonder if, like, maybe my internet just went away, and then I thought you got froze, and then, you know what I mean? Because when I came back on, and then I, like, it actually finally let me back in the Hangout, and then, but it didn't kick me out, like, you know what I mean? But then all of a sudden it was like, you want to restart the Hangout? And I'm like, what, you know? So then it's, I don't know. So I wonder if it was actually my internet that crapped out, and I guess we're somewhere now. Confused. Let me try to get the comments up so I can see if anybody's here.
Technical issues. If this is your first time watching, that's not this.
I've been having a really hard time, like, updating the show notes and getting the title up and everything like that. Oh, so Nikki did make it over, at least. At least one of them came.
So. Okay. Hey, Nikki.
She's in the chat. I was in the midst of asking her how her daily, you know, art selling thing was going. I don't know if she heard that, but I'd love to hear how that stuff's going for her. Hopefully going well. And Nikki, you know, if you want to come on the show, I don't know if you're busy or you got a webcam or something, but you're welcome. Just send me a message and I could get you on one of them here in the future. So
yeah,
you seem nice. So we like to have nice people on.
That would just like audio.
Say hi. Yeah. You know what bugs me, Peter, actually, that I saw this morning? That it's not always just this morning, but it happens every now and then, is when somebody else, like, tags you in their, like, Facebook post and it doesn't have anything to do with you.
Yeah, I mean, it hasn't happened in a while since me. You know, like, I get tagged a lot nowadays, but it's all related to what I'm doing.
Yeah, I don't mind if I go there and it's like there's something to do with me, but it really kind of bugs me when I go there and it's like just somebody trying to hawk their, you know, sketch cards or something, and I'm just like, I ain't got nothing to do with this.
Yeah, well, that's when I start, you know, messaging people and meeting people.
I know.
It can easily be a problem.
Yeah. So don't do that if you're out there doing that. Listen to my show. I think that's just kind of rude, you know. I'm not quite sure what they want. Do they want me to see it, or are they just... I kind of think what they're trying to do is trying to, you know, get my audience to go over and look at their auctions and stuff. Which I get that, but, you know, it's... I don't know.
There are better ways.
Yeah, do it better.
I mean, at least ask.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. I mean, ask for me to share your link. That's an easier way to do it. Just go like, "Hey, Jeff, you mind sharing some of my stuff?" Because I'll probably do it. But I don't know. I just feel like it's got nothing to do with me, you know.
So yeah. Anyway,
there's a little complaint.
See, Mike doesn't show up. See what happens.
Right. Yeah. We're going into the pit again. So, and then Ryder Ove came over too. So, hey, Ryder Ove, I'm glad you made it over here.
Hey.
We don't know what happened to the show. So. And Nikki says it's going really well and she's selling a lot. And and she says she'll come on once she gets her camera figured out and stuff. So,
yeah, well, you know, the invitation's open. So, there you go.
Yep.
Yeah.
And also, Marshall said he might come on, so if he gets to the like right truck stop or something. Sounds like he's at work or something, so who knows. I did listen to his show, the one we were talking about, with the kind of, it said something about responsibility or taking responsibility for your failures or something.
Right.
And, we're talking about his thing about Patreon, but then I actually liked the show a lot, but it was more because he was kind of harping on the email list and all that, and yeah, that's something I really need to like kind of start working on, is building that email list, you know, like one that I can really use, you know what I mean? Because I have an email list, and it's like, you know, just like this morning, I posted the blog, I didn't send out the, you know, an email to the subscribers, and I've been really bad about that for the last couple weeks, you know. But, you know, my email list is really small still. I have, like, another list, which is, like, my customers off of eBay, but I don't really spam them with blog posts and stuff. You know, I kind of hold that back for when I really need a sale. And then I'll kind of handpick a few emails and send it to those guys. But I don't know. You know, like, I used to have the subscribe button on like my blogger website that went to FeedBurner or something, you know? Remember how they used to have that thing?
Right.
And then I was like noticing, like when I was doing the blog post today, it's like that, like my site has like about 300 subscribers on that FeedBurner thing, but I took that off of there and I replaced it with my email or like my newsletter or email list or whatever you want to call it. And I don't know what I've got on that list. Maybe, you know, 20 or 25 people. Hardly any people have signed up for it. Just probably because I haven't pushed it much. But I don't know, you know, with all this, like, Facebook-type stuff, you know, it's like, it is one way to kind of keep in contact with your...
with the people who want to watch the show, you know? Yeah, Nikki says, I miss Mike and hope he's better soon. Yeah, if anybody, I don't know if I mentioned it, like, I don't know, if anybody knows what's going on, but he had to go to the chiropractor, so he's having the back problems and all that stuff, so he should be back soon. I don't know, he might actually be gone for a few days, because it sounded like this is going to be, like, for a few mornings, he's going to have to go and see this guy, so, yeah. But eventually he'll probably be back. He said that, like, you know, he's just super sore, and, you know, now he's, like, scared to stop going to this guy because it seems to be getting worse. So I hope this dude knows what he's doing. He's not just making it worse, but it's probably just my skeptical mind.
Well, sometimes I kind of, you know, attention to your back, that's what happens. It gets sore before it gets better.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's a longer process, and yeah, just hope it's not too painful and too long going. And
yeah. But it's like, I know when I did that thing where I pulled that muscle in my ribs or whatever, it took a long time for that thing to kind of like get normal again. It took like, you know, I'd say a couple weeks just to kind of quit hurting, and then it took a while after that to, you know, go away.
Yeah.
It takes a while for that kind of stuff to heal. I think it's because you're always, you know, you use your, like, you know, your stomach muscles and everything for everything. So you're just always, you know, just getting up and getting down, you use those.
Well, let's see, I got a message from somebody. I don't know, nothing. It's just people liking the Artcast. Also, like, so you were talking about your new house that you're going to get, too. You want to go and talk about that? I want to hear the rest of that story.
Well, to reiterate, since we're starting the hangout, you know, I'll give the shorter version. I don't know. You know, having problems, the landlord is coming down on everybody in the community I'm living in. On people with animals, and I initially thought, well, you know, we'll just pay the fee for all four cats. I got four cats, but we can only pay the fee for one. We can only have one animal in the home, and that really sucks. So we, you know, try to get them or you know, special services out there. We try to get temporary housing, and it just nothing is happening. So Lisa, my girlfriend, fiance, thought she'd look into, you know, renting something, buying something, and it was a trailer at first, but that was smaller, like, space-wise than what we have now, plus we have to get land, you know.
Yeah.
But yesterday we went and saw a house that we pretty much both fell in love with. It's pretty big. It's three bedrooms, two bathrooms, a, you know, not much of a backyard, but a big front yard and sort of side yard space. Really, you know, good looking neighborhood. You know, there's his home there. A lot of people with boats, because it's somewhat near the lake.
Cool. But,
you know, it's like if you go far back in our backyard, there's the dam back there, and then the lake. And yeah, I mean, it's like there's a forest behind us, and we're just thinking like, you know, there's lots of small trees around the house. It probably looks gorgeous during the summer. You know, there's, it's a fixer-upper. There's not really a kitchen. You know, the kitchen room, and a burner oven something standing in there. It's not finished. It's not even painted. I don't know. We'll have to go back. But the rest of the house is freshly painted. Everything, like the rugs and the tile, looks good, like, except for, like, there's a stain in the living room, I think it was. Or the dining room, I forget. But big deal. I don't care. the house is going to need a lot of work, but you know, the big question is, can we afford it? And you know, we don't have, barely covering bills right now. We're going to have to come up with a large sum of money to be figured out. If we could do it, you know, I really think like it's an inexpensive home that, you know, it's like $39,000. Yeah, and, you know, and change depending, you know, we'll talk to the realtor. There's like, it's a huge garage, but there's no doors on the garage. It's like two car garage. So you need two doors. You could talk them down for that. There's no like real asphalt or concrete or even rocks on the path to the house. So you could probably talk them down on that. And there's no kitchen to speak of. you know, there's like things we can negotiate with.
Is that like an average price for like where you live, $39,000, or is that kind of like a
I don't know, cheap price? Like, we kind of talked to a couple other people, and you know, people seem to say that it's low price.
Yeah.
It might be because of location. It's like there's really nothing near it.
Yeah.
We'd actually have to come back to town to go shopping.
Yeah.
So we'll probably travel a lot less, and it's, you know, we're homebodies as it is, but but you know, I mean, we'd be ecstatic to have that home.
Yeah.
You know, we'll just do a weekly food trip or something.
Yeah.
You know, see family and all that jazz in one run. It was really amazing.
You know what I mean? You just start like buying enough stuff to make it for a while, you know?
Yeah. There's the initial lump sum, whatever that we'll have to come up with, as well as a bigger monthly payment. But I'm thinking, you know, things are progressing, things are moving forward. I might be able to swing some sort of better gig, and you know, if I could have that under my belt and start putting together product, you know, a little money here, a little money there will help out.
Well, that price to keep those dang cats, at least, you know, when you thought you could keep them, was pretty high. I mean, I would think, you know, especially for a house, like, I mean, because, like, 30 grand is actually incredibly cheap for, like, I don't think you could find a house in Colorado for that. You know, like here, you know, 200,000 is like the bottom end. It's like an expensive area, you know. But
well, it's 39. It's like 40,000.
40. Yeah.
But that's, I don't know. I don't keep track of prices, but I don't know. I'm from New York. You know, get nothing less than 100,000.
Absolutely. It's probably not even like that anymore. But yeah, I think it sounds like a steal, really. And yeah, I mean, like, you know, like I think you were saying, like 2,000. I'm sure if you had 2 grand, you could probably get into that place, huh?
Well, we're thinking maybe it might be like 6,000.
Oh, really? Okay.
Just, you know, because, you know, we're not a young couple, so we might have to go for a shorter.
Yeah. Around here, though, like 10% is like a pretty average, like, down payment, which is that's only 4 grand on 40,000. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it remains to be seen. We're going to call the realtor and set up an appointment. We kind of, like, just went into the house. It was open.
Yeah. I think it sounds great, dude.
It's just beautiful. I mean, it's a big yellow house and you know, surrounded by trees and grass. And,
yeah.
Has well, but it was stuffed with... what you want? Insulation? I don't know why. We've got to figure it out.
Yeah. When do we start the GoFundMe campaign for the house? I like this one better than the cats.
I'd be ready to start it right now. Let's go.
looks like Marshall came in. Hey, Marshall.
Hey, Marshall. Get audio?
He's got no audio. Are you muted, dude?
But technical issues today, all around. Saw the mute button come up and go away. I still don't hear anything, though. Do you hear anything?
No, not yet.
Remember the last time you came on, I think you had this problem.
How about now?
Oh, there we go. All
right. Yeah, no, I constantly change my audio and video settings for different reasons, so it's always an issue.
You're probably always sending them through mics and stuff, and then, yeah, that makes sense.
Exactly.
How's it going?
All right, man. How you guys doing?
Pretty good. How come you're home from work? You quit your job or something?
Yeah, I was like, screw this. I can't get on Hangouts. I'm going to quit so I can go do Hangouts. We had a delivery or whatever, and then I was just like, we're waiting on customers and stuff. I'm like, you want me to just take lunch first?
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
Taking an early lunch. Yeah.
Yep. So, but the iPhone one doesn't seem to work. I, clicked the new link and again, it said I was the first one to join the call, so.
Oh, that's weird.
Yeah, I don't know. Some kind of bug maybe they need to fix or something.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know what happened on that first call, but just all ended and I don't know. I was talking, Peter was talking, nobody was hearing any of us.
fun.
Yeah, I know.
So Lisa just messaged me. She's like, when can we go for a viewing? I was like, we can do it later today. Let me know.
Awesome. Yeah. Peter's getting a new house, maybe.
Well, we're dreaming at the moment.
Yeah.
I
did that once, but.
You did that once?
Yeah, I was dreaming once to get a house.
Oh, yeah.
And that was like right when the market crashed, and I was like, well, that dream's over. I'm lucky to keep my job right now, so.
Yeah. Well, after that crash happened, we were looking at some of them ones, you know, some of these ones that were repossessed and stuff. They actually got cheap for a while here.
Mm.
That would have been the time to buy, but
no doubt.
Go back up now.
Yeah, but I mean, my pay went down too. So, like, because I didn't get any overtime,
yeah.
So it was like, you know, it's yeah, the house, you know, the it's cheaper to get a house now, but now I have less pay. So, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. That sucks.
Plus, I'm not really a handyman, so. You know, it's kind of better off. Somebody yeah. else takes care of that stuff.
I was telling Lisa, like, you know, I can't do everything. I'll do some stuff. But actually, you know, she's still good friends with her ex-husband who does a lot of stuff. And her uncle lives really near the house, who's handy, you know, kind of a handyman himself. So we got, like, people come and pitch in.
Well, that's cool.
Yeah.
I'm only a handyman by need.
Yeah. I mean, I do some of that, yeah. too. Like, I can, you know, do some things, but I'd rather not. I almost rather just rent, let somebody else take care of it. Like, the snow has been ridiculous. Like, every single Monday, they're, like, closing down the state the last 3 weeks.
Yeah. And,
like, I'm just glad I don't have to shovel or anything. I just go turn my car on and go. Clean it off, maybe, but I park it under a portico or whatever, so even yeah. that's, like, minimal.
Yeah. Yeah, it's funny. It's like every time I see one of your pictures, yeah, it's like freaking snow up to your eyeballs. And then here in Colorado, it's been like so fucking nice. I mean, it's like literally like summer outside for this last week.
That is kind of crazy.
I know. For February, it's really weird.
I love shoveling, but we have no snow here. So.
You like yeah. shoveling?
But yeah, I mean, you know, whether it's picking up leaves or shoveling or, you know, it's physical activity I don't get while I'm sitting on my ass and inking or drawing
yeah.
or whatever.
I could see that if I was doing,
I see that.
Yeah, this kind of work all the time, I could see that, but I'm doing physical work all the time, so I don't like it.
But, yeah, it's almost fun to do that kind of stuff sometimes. And then, I don't know, when you got to do it, is your job every day, you just get sick of it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's like when I had day jobs, I'd get physical work. You know, I wouldn't get, you know, like anything art-related. I'd get something where I was, you know, using my muscles and whatnot. The opposite of art.
So I actually listened to Lean Into Art today, which I haven't listened to that show, which it's like the only art show that I always would definitely listen to, and I haven't listened really? To it for months and months and months, but it was nice to kind of finally go back and check back in with those guys. You know, I kind of forget because he was all over the place all the time, but and I just always listened to him. I kind of took it for granted, but I mean, Jersey is just a top-notch, you know, broadcaster in whatever he does. And I mean, you know, I really dig Rob too as well. But man, Jersey, I love listening to him talk. I kind of wish he would do like his own show a little more often too. Like I like the Lean Into Art. I like Thunder Punch. But I used to like when he even had comics are great, but I used to like when he did Thunder Punch a lot more too, like back in the Art and Story days.
Right.
He always had some like interesting insights and stuff, you know.
Yeah, I really like that Thunder Punch one he did, where it was just him.
Mm-hmm.
That was cool.
He keeps that going for his patrons, I believe.
Yeah.
It's hard to, I don't, you know, it's, the thing with listening to podcasts, and this is patron fault, like, you know, I listen to stuff that's on my iTunes, and if I'm a patron of somebody and they have a new podcast that's not public, listen to it.
Oh, I don't either. That's the thing. Like, when, you know, they have all that stuff in the Patreon feed, and I would listen to all of it because I love Rob's show by himself, too. I love all those shows right. that they put out. I would listen to absolutely all of it, even the stuff where they're just, like, sitting around talking about nothing, you know? I mean, that's what I watch, you know, these shows, and, you know,
hey,
you talk about all kinds of different stuff. Well, you know what I mean. You guys talk about and, like, the weather.
Yeah, I know.
So, but, like, we were just talking about the weather.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, I mean, I would listen to all that stuff, but it's not convenient, so I didn't listen to any of it except for the main, you know, show.
I agree. I used to be such a fan of that show, and I have dropped off somewhat, and the only one that really pops up, like, my thing is YouTube. I don't pay attention to iTunes. And it's like, unless it's like in my YouTube feed, I just, they just don't get a look for me, and it kind of sucks, you know?
Yeah.
Because at one point they did something where they like changed it from like, you had to sign up for the newsletter or something to get like every other show on YouTube or, and that just was like, and I even went and signed up. I don't know what happened to the newsletter. So it must have went into my spam folder or something. But it really irritated me that I had to do that, you know?
Right. So do they, because I know all their stuff is video as well. Is that stuff on YouTube too? Because I never see that in my feed.
Yeah, it's like on a channel that's called Lean Into Art.
Okay.
That's actually where I listen to it. You're still listening to it as a podcast then?
Well, I don't, but that's why I want to get it on YouTube, because today I listened to it as a podcast, and, you know, if I had it on YouTube, I'd probably listen to it more.
Hmm. Yeah, it's like, it's on there. Yeah, it's just, I think it's, their channel's called Lean Into Art. Okay. And the whole show's on there and everything. And then also the ones he does at the library go into that feed too.
Oh, cool.
Which is kind of cool.
Yeah, I like those too.
Yeah. Which I thought that was kind of funny, like later, you know, like he's had his wife on a couple times lately. And then she's actually like a librarian at the library. Which I thought was kind of funny, because he's like always, you know, with this library and teaching at the libraries and stuff, and then you know, it makes sense now. It's like, oh, well, your wife's a, you know, librarian, so that's how that all started, I'm sure, you know. So, pretty cool.
Well, I mean, that whole connection with the library is really cool, and I never, you know, if it wasn't for him, I didn't even know that, you know, libraries carried comics, you know.
I know.
And now, come to find out, it's almost one of the best venues for comics.
Yeah.
Even almost over, you know, comic shops.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I haven't went to many comic shops lately, but I used to go and browse the comics at the library when I used to hang out at the library for my internet, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But I don't go there no more because I have internet at home finally, so... I kind of did that on purpose for a while, like when I first started doing sketch cards, I was worried that I would start wasting time at home, and I don't know, I had a laptop, so I would just like, you know, jump on my bike, ride it to the library and do my stuff there, but it keeps you in shape and everything, but it's just like, you know, eventually it just gets to be too much of a pain.
Right.
You know, they're closed for weird reasons and stuff, and you're like, oh, what the hell with this?
Well, when you go online in the library, I mean, I remember back, like, way back in the dark ages of the internet.
Yeah.
When, you know, you go there, and it's like, if you want to connect, you can connect, but only for, like, 20 minutes at a time or something. Or, like, you have to, like, get passes or whatever. Because there was only, like, one or two computers. I don't know how many there is now in these places, but...
Yeah, our library is actually still like that. They have all the computers lined up, and then people, you know, have the time thing or something.
But if you bring your own laptop, you could stay on forever.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, now with Wi-Fi, I can imagine. I forgot about that.
Yeah, that's how I used to do it.
That's the difference. So Jay might be drawing out.
Oh, cool.
Hmm. I'm only seeing Jersey Joe's channel, which I'm subscribed to, but I don't see a Lean Into Art channel. I guess it must be on his channel.
Is the are the Lean Into Arts on Jersey's channel?
Yeah, I could have swore that it might be.
Yeah, I could have swore it actually said Lean Into Art in the channel, but.
Okay. Yeah, I'm just not seeing it for some reason. I'll find it.
Yeah. Maybe it was just his, because I'm sure that I was probably watching him before he started sticking that on YouTube.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I used to see the Lean Into Art show up, and I'm not seeing it now. I know, I don't know. Rob set up the last one, didn't I? Didn't see it anymore.
I seen one recently. I wonder if they have kind of dropped off, because just thinking about it, I haven't actually been watching that show much either. And you know, I just don't pay attention. I just, you know, whenever I see it in my email, I just like go watch it. So if they don't post it, then you know, I'm probably not going over there to check for it.
Yeah.
And then like I remember, you know, like he's got, you know, not to bust on him, but it's like, that's definitely like one of those things where he's posting like so many places. It's like, and I don't know how you not do it this way, but it's like it's easy to miss stuff. Cause like in one of his shows recently, he was talking about, this was right around the time when Kevin did his 100 Days of Comics and all that, and then they just did like a 30 days of like audio basically or something kind of challenge. And then he started that, you know, the Thunder Punch thing up again just for that and did it for 30 days. And I missed that whole thing, you know what I mean? I was like, just listening to the show, he's like talking about it. And I'm like, you're kidding me, you did 30 podcasts, I didn't even see him? You know? So, jeez. I don't know. So then I went back and I started listening, but, you know.
Yeah, it looks like I just went to their website and you know, just clicked on the YouTube link on their website, and it brings it right to Jersey's channel. So I guess it's
hosted there. Oh, so it must be his then. Yeah. I don't know what I'm talking about.
I get his webcomic updates. I don't know why I don't get his video updates.
Where do you get those at? Off the site or something?
On G Plus or YouTube, you know, as a notification.
Hmm. Yeah. It's a pretty good show. I liked it when Mark and Kevin were on it a lot. I think that was my favorite.
Oh yeah.
I like the new guy too, Rob. He's pretty cool.
Yeah, there was something about the chemistry, specifically even before Kevin got on there, like just Mark and Jersey obviously have a relationship that goes way back, and I don't know, just that chemistry between them, and then all three of them were just, they had something that was, I think, a little unique, you know?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
Like a lot of good things that happen, it's only for a period of time, the magic, you know.
What do you say, Peter? All good things come to an end? No.
Oh, no.
Not this show, dude. We're going to be 80 years old on here. They're going to have to drag us kicking and screaming off the internet.
Sounds good to me.
Well, maybe that's because our show's not that good. It just hangs in there.
I listen to hours and hours of this show, so it's decent.
Yeah, we don't do the topics and stuff. That would be so hard.
To stay to a topic.
That's also like, why in some ways, like, when I have to stop listening to Jersey Shores, I mean, that's like his show, that's like why, though, is because it's like sometimes, you know, he's so in-depth on the artist thing and, like, artist block and the artist this and, you know, that sometimes I can't listen to it because it's like he's bringing one on, you know. He's like talking about having a hard time writing, and all of a sudden I can't draw because I'm thinking all this stuff's running in my head, you know.
Yeah. I get that. I kind of feel similar, and it's funny because, like, the thing is they think way harder about most stuff than I would ever think about. Yeah.
I really think so.
Yeah. Which is cool. Yeah. It expands my mind a little bit to think a little deeper about this stuff, but, you know, I would, like, go into panic trying to create a comic thinking about all that stuff. Like,
yeah.
Yeah. So Jay's here. Hey, Jay.
Oh.
Can we hear you?
Hey, guys.
Hey, what's up, Jay?
Hey, Jay. Finally made it on.
Yeah. Well, I was telling Peter, you know, daytime can be kind of hectic with me because I got to deal with a lot of customers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's understandable. You got the real studio going or whatever, like the real business. So we're just all sitting in our house.
Goofing off.
Yeah. We're like lonely to talk to people. You're probably trying to get rid of them.
Honestly, yeah. It's kind of the truth. I know, because, you know, I've said it before. You know, you get these customers showing up, and it's like they want to bring lunch and sit down with you and hang out all day. And like, come on, man, I got to work.
Oh, wow.
I get that on my job all the time, too. It's like, I got to get this stuff done, dude.
Man. Yeah, I had that happen a couple times, like back when I was doing comics and stuff, and I'd go to cons and you'd meet up with people and you get a little too friendly, and you know you don't want to be unfriendly, but you know, not everybody is. Some people are cool to hang out with, some people maybe not, and then suddenly, you know, they'd be like, hey, you know, I'd love to see your studio, and you'd be going out to lunch with some guy, you know, and it's just like, why am I doing this?
Yeah, a friend of mine used to have a tattoo shop, and half the time I'd go and, you know, go there, be just a gang of people. It's like, is anybody working today?
Yeah. Yeah, tattoos, that sounds like a hard business. I've never messed around with that, but I've had some friends who have tried that kind of thing.
It's one of those things that everybody who's not an artist who knows you says you should do.
Yeah, totally. I still get those suggestions on YouTube all the time.
It's good money, but it's not my scene.
Isn't it, like, hard to kind of get into, like, I know a ton of guys who have, like, you know, they could tattoo and do a pretty decent, of course, they're probably not really awesome, but and then they get into, like, some little old shop, and they can't get anybody to come, and, you know, and then it's like that goes out of business, and they end up somewhere else. And
yeah, and you got to be an apprentice. You have to be an apprentice and not make any money for a while, too, and not even do tattoos for a while.
Oh, wow.
Which is like, ugh, I can't jump into something like that, you know, I got to just jump all the way in if I'm going to do it, you know.
Yeah.
Kind of like somebody's tattoo, so it is a process to go through.
Yeah, I actually did a little bit of tattooing just on my buddy, because he was like, same thing, you should tattoo. Okay, I just bought all this stuff, come over and fill in my tattoos. I'm like, I've never done this before.
Oh, but man.
He was okay with it, and I was a little interested at least to see what it was like, so I was like, okay, I'll do it, and that's when I found out it wasn't for me, because you're sitting there like pressing needles into people and hurting them. And I'm just not good at just continuously hurting people. Like,
yeah.
I can't do it.
Yeah.
That's the reason why I'm not a doctor.
Yeah.
I don't deal with needles and people.
Yeah, I don't think I'd like that part of it either.
I'm too, like, I'm the type of person who's, like, really generally, like, if you know me in person, I'm pretty quiet and sensitive to people's needs. Like, I don't want to, like, step on anybody's toes or anything. So that, to me, is just stressful.
Yeah. Yeah, well, you know, it is like anything else. You get into it, you get used to it, you know, it becomes the thing you do. You know, you just have to be really good with customers and on top of how things are going. And, you know, if they're cringing, that's probably a problem.
Well, not really. I mean,
I know, don't they
professional
all
tattooists, you know, they make people cringe all the time, but that's the thing. I mean, have you ever got... I've never gotten a tattoo, but, I mean, it's painful from what I hear. And, you know, you got some people can't do it even. Can't even be tattooed.
Yeah. Yeah, I saw this guy at Walmart the other day. He had, like, these tattoos on his face. I was it's a commitment, man.
You gotta sign a waiver for that.
Yeah.
Oh, that looks awesome. That little stencil you got going there, starting up there.
Well, hopefully it's going to turn out okay.
I'm sure it will.
You're starting out on, like, a black piece of...
Yeah, this is a black piece of aluminum.
Wow.
Is that for a job, or is that a personal piece?
No, it's for a job, actually. I done a bike for this guy, and it's going into a show, so this panel, and I'm just doing it's pretty much the same piece that's on the front fender, but you put this panel in front of the bike at the show, and it'll have, like, the guy's name and the bike's name and the year of the bike and all that kind of crap.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, that's neat. Yeah, I heard you talking about how, I was listening to you and Peter, you're talking about how, like, the Canadian artists don't get along and stuff. I thought that was interesting. Like, there's a lot of competition in the airbrushing motorcycle field and all that.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's actually, it's really cutthroat.
Yeah.
Like I was saying, like, around here, because motorcycles, it's really a seasonal thing, obviously, because we get winters, so... There's only so many bike shops, and I mean, there's lots of bike shops, but all the painters really compete for the business, so I think by nature, they just, all painters don't like each other. And I mean, I'm not that way at all. I'm more than happy to talk to anybody, but yeah, like, there's just this real dislike for that painters have for each other.
Yeah. That's funny. I could kind of see it, though. I've been in different, you know, places where I felt that. Kind of like, you know, you're stepping on somebody's toes. And, I don't know. But, like, I don't know. On the internet, pretty much, it's been the opposite. Everybody seems pretty supportive and stuff, but... I don't know.
It can be kind of a weird industry sometimes. I guess it'd probably be the same for you. Like, if you go to a convention or something, you'd probably, you know, if, like, an artist alley kind of thing, like, would the artists around you get kind of, like, would there be any animosity?
Yeah, I really have never felt that at, like, a con or, you know, like, when you're sitting at a table. It's always, like, it almost seems like we pair up and, you know, like, you end up with, like, a bunch of friends when you leave those places. I've kind of felt that, though, at some of these, like, outdoor-type shows, you know? Like, when you got a bunch of guys in the booths and all that kind of stuff, you know? You start asking them about, like, where they're going and all how things are going and stuff. And it's sort of like, you know, once they realize you're not buying, it's like they don't want to talk to you no more, you know?
Yeah.
Which is weird. But maybe that's just, you know, because of the... You're bringing in so much more of a sales, which, you know, you guys are in the same way, you know? There's, like... You got customers and their sales, and it's, like, all right there, and it's a lot more, you know. like an industry, whereas like with comics, you know, you're kind of, I don't know, you know, your sales at a con ain't even really your income a lot of times. It's more like you're there to get work and stuff, so.
Yeah.
Then I've also had friends, and, you know, that jealousy thing has played into it, for sure. Just because artists are artists, I guess.
Yeah, it's the nature of the beast.
Right. You want art friends, but then sometimes they piss you off. And then sometimes one gets more, you know, it starts working for them, and then another one doesn't like it, and, you know, I don't know. I've had that shit happen all the time. Different friends fighting.
Yeah, jealousy.
What'd you say? Oh, jealousy, yeah.
Jealousy.
Yeah. Doesn't get you nothing, though. And everybody's career is different.
Yep.
You know, so much of it, like, depends on, like, breaks or, like, you know, the opportunities that come. You just can't sort of pattern yourself after. Just because it's happening one way for one guy doesn't mean it's going to happen that way for you, you know.
Absolutely. Did Marshall drop off, though? He's gone, I guess.
Maybe his lunch is over.
Back to work. To the slave mines. Yeah, that was a good show. Jay? Oh, go ahead.
Sorry, what was that?
What's new, Jay?
Anything? What's new?
Yeah.
Absolutely nothing. I do the same thing every day. Wake up, paint, go to bed.
I thought that was interesting, you know, like when you guys were talking, because it's like that is, you know, you went right into like art, you know what I mean? And I think like everybody I know always like, you know, we were all going for that kind of a job, you know what I mean? But we like spent like years and years sort of like building up to it, you know. But you like, you know, you like, and I'm not saying it's easy, but it was like, you know, you were talking about, you know, the t-shirt shop and then like, you know, the motorcycle stuff came later, and it was just like you went right into art, which was really cool. You know, but I can see how you, like, if you did that, you'd look at it a lot more like, you know, this is my job, this is what I do every day. Just like when I was going and painting houses or doing drywall or whatever.
Yeah, you know, like, I really, God, for like 20 years, it's been a job.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's funny though, because like, even when I started out, like, when I first got into it, like, everybody I knew, all my friends, and especially my family, they all thought I was out of my mind. Like, you're going to open up a t-shirt shop in a mall? What the hell are you thinking? But I have a tendency to not listen to anybody anyway, so I just did it.
Yeah. That makes sense. I think that probably served you well, you know. I don't know. I remember when I quit my job, and you were, like, one of the first guys that kind of started commenting on, like, the videos once I started doing them again, and it was like, I always remember, like, your comments, because it was, like, they were in, you know, everybody else was kind of like, you're really going to quit your job, you know, I mean, they were sort of really, and then, like, you were always just like, yeah, you know, I did it whenever, and just go for it, and you'll be fine. You know? I don't know.
It's weird, though, because, you know, a lot of people, they think of art as a hobby, like, they really can't imagine it being a full-time 9-to-5 job, you know?
Yeah.
Not that it's really 9-to-5, but
right.
If you dedicate yourself to it, then yeah, you're going to make it work one way or the other.
Yeah. In your, like, shop, do you have, like, assistants, like, when you're having to paint, like, big car hoods and stuff like that help you out with some of it, or is it just you, or does somebody else there work with you, or?
Well, I mean, everything I do by myself, but my body guy, Roger, he does all the body work and the base coat and clear coat. If I got something big I got to move around, he'll help me do it. Yeah.
Yeah. That's cool. I see. So do you guys, is part of the shop, like, doing body work also, and then you're in with those guys, like, painting them also in the same kind of place, or? Not really.
Well, the body shop is, Roger's shop is a custom shop. Like, all we do is bikes. Like, all he does is bikes, so, and he works by himself, and I'm just in a little studio right above the body shop, and I do my thing by myself.
I see. And it probably works, like, awesome.
Yeah, like, you know, we work together, but we're individuals at the same time, you know?
Yeah. And the customers coming for, like, custom cars and stuff. Probably a lot of times looking for somebody to paint something cool on the hood and stuff. Yeah. Or the bikes, I guess.
That makes sense.
I used to like watching that one show with the motorcycle guys who were fixing up the I can't remember what that called. The Chopper show?
Oh, American Chopper. Yeah, good. But you know what? Those shows are so true because I work with so many shops and thankfully I know they're not gonna be watching me here on YouTube. Like, they're all idiots. Like, they all work like that.
Right. Yeah, and I'm sure it gets even worse once you get guys in there with cameras watching you.
Yeah. Like some of these chefs, they're funny as hell. Like, they'll call me and say, we got a customer here. We're building a custom bike, and he wants to talk about the paint job. Okay, fine. So I'll go down, spend an hour or so talking to the guy. It'll be you're trying to figure out the time frame. Like, okay, is this going into a show or what's going on? I'll be like, yeah, it's got to go into a show in 3 months. And then what'll happen is and this is with every single shop that I work for. They'll spend 2.5 months working on that bike, and they'll literally give it to me, and they're like, okay, you got a week to do the whole thing.
Oh wow.
And so every time, like, I give them shit every time, and I've been doing this for, I don't know how many years, but it never changes.
Yeah. So even in, like, your business, it's like, you know, people do all their shit and they push it all down, and then you're like the artist and you got to finish everything in the
in what's left. I know, that's a brutal thing. Like, I'm not going to say I have the hardest part of the job, but paint job's the first thing you see and the thing you're going to remember about the bike, and they really give you no time to do what you got to do.
Wow.
I mean, I'm used to it. I don't like it, but I'm used to it.
Yeah. When they go into, like, shows and stuff, is that what happens to a lot of those bikes? I mean, is that the motivation to make them and stuff? Is, like, these shows, like, a big deal in the bike world? I don't know. I'm, like, not real familiar with it.
Yeah, like, when you're dealing with competition-level bikes, like, you know, like, say you can go to a Harley dealership, you can pick up a Harley, like a low ride, a diner or something like that, for $20,000.
Yeah.
When you're dealing with a custom bike, you're usually looking, like, the cost involved into that is anywhere from $60,000 to $100,000 is invested in these bikes.
Wow.
Yeah, and then they'll pay a few thousand for the paint job, but when you're doing the competitions, like, if you, like, the Motorcycle Super Show in Toronto, like, first place, I believe it's $15,000 cash, and then for everything that you have it entered in, like, they have best bike, best concept, best paint, best motor, best chrome, etc., etc. Every prize that you win, you know, it's another couple grand. Like, it's very rare, but sometimes one bike will pretty much take all the top prizes, and that guy will be walking away with nearly $50,000.
Wow.
Yeah. So it's kind of like an investment when they do these competition bikes, because all they really do is they'll put it in a trailer and they're just driving around from show to show to show all year round.
Yeah, I see.
And then, you know, if you get lucky, you know, like a big a magazine like VQ or V-Twin will pick you up and they'll do an article on you, and then that boosts their business and they make money off it, you know?
Yeah. That's wild. Yeah. Yeah, I've had a couple people ask me to try to, like, paint something on the car gas tank and shit, and it's I've always been, I just don't even know where to start. I usually just say, I don't know, dude.
Well, you know, you could definitely, I'm pretty sure you could pull something like that off. It's, like, with your style, it's pretty cool, but
yeah.
That would actually be really unique on a bike. The only thing I would say is definitely pick up some blank pieces of metal and practice on that before you
give it a try before I mess somebody's up. Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I'm not trying to like, take a shot or anything, but
No, I think that's some good advice.
I had to do a lot of practice before I would commit to doing a bike.
Yeah. There's this is all back like when I was a kid, but I had a friend who agreed to paint this guy's hood, and so he, you know, gets the hood and gets it in his dad's garage, and you know, it pretty much stayed there for 2 years while he painted a giant bat on it. Yeah. You know, we didn't know what kind of paint or anything like that, and I think he did a lot of it like just with acrylics and shit, and I don't know. I never heard the story. I don't know if you ever even delivered the thing back to the guy. So we were just kids, though. And it was his deal, not mine, so.
As long as your name's not attached to it, it's all good.
That's right. We had that other guy on that. I don't know, the Artcaster's chat sometimes. His name was Sid Airbrush, I think, or... Well, that was his handle, you know, I'm sure it wasn't his name.
Yeah, I'd seen him on the show before, yeah.
Seen him on there, yeah. I haven't seen him for a while. I don't know what happened to him. He's just being quiet. Got off Facebook for a while. I really want to try that trick. I think I'm actually going to try it on this piece I'm doing here, that one where you sprayed that acrylic varnish, you know, the clear acrylic.
Yeah.
I think I'm going to try that. I used to use that stuff that I would paint it on. I used to use it on my sketch cards, but I just painted on with a brush, which, you know, left all these weird brush strokes. I never tried spraying it, so...
Yeah, if you spray it, the finish is... it comes out beautiful.
Yeah.
The only thing I'd say is, are you going to do it through your airbrush?
No, I think I'm going to try to pick up a little cup gun, like what you said.
Yeah, because if you don't use a big gun, you'll end up getting... I mean, it's like if you were trying to base one of your boards all one color, you know how you get it gets all streaky and whatnot if you do it with your airbrush?
Yeah.
Yeah, like, you really got to use a big gun and just open it up. But
I see.
Yeah, I mean, like, I think the finish is fantastic. I love it. I do it with all my stuff.
Yeah. Well, I like that, because even with a brush, it evens it up and stuff, you know? But I just always, like, the brush lines don't look like they're paint brush lines, so people, like, almost mention that. They're like, hey, you know, this brush line's going this way, and looks like you painted this one this way, and I never liked that about it, so... But I really do like that finish, and it seems super durable.
Yeah.
Hey. I have found out some information about the house.
Okay. Breaking news. Let's hear it, Peter.
It was a trailer that added the garage and the living room. There were cabinets in the kitchen that somebody sold.
Yeah.
There is heat, but there's not emergency heat. If it goes down too far, you know, there's no backup or something.
What do you mean, like, there's no, like, just stove or something? What kind of emergency heat you mean?
Well, like, if it gets too cold, there's no kind of real heat.
There's, like, no furnace in the place?
Or there's a small furnace, but it's not really palatable. I don't totally know. There's no water, like it's runoff well water.
Yeah.
But it's probably frozen.
Does it freeze that cold down there? I mean, if it's a well, I mean, I don't know why it would be frozen. You know, that's like a legitimate water source.
Well, it's probably, you know, it's the well that's in front of the house that's for that specific home.
Yeah, I mean, we used to have a well up in the mountains, and a lot of the houses I've lived in have wells, and they're fine, you know.
Yeah, but there's maintenance on wells, right?
Not so much. No? They pretty much take care of themselves, yeah.
Well, we saw the house on Google Maps.
Yeah.
And that house hasn't been lived in a long time.
Yeah. Usually, you know, like a well, like the pump is way down in the well, and then usually they have a cap on it or something, and then they have some insulation, so it's pretty much set up not to freeze unless just something weird happened. But
well, like I said, we looked in it, and there was just insulation, like, stacked on top of it.
Yeah, that's probably just to keep it from freezing or getting cold, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So that's something we'll have to look in. And the front of the house where the living room is has to be propped up because it's not secure, I guess.
The front of the what has to be?
Like the living room is an add-on to the trailer, and it's not properly secure.
Hmm. Like the whole room?
well, the front of the room.
Yeah.
Like, it just looks... I mean, we saw it, and it just looks like it's hanging.
Yeah.
But other than that...
Does it got electricity?
Yeah, but the wiring in the kitchen has to be redone. So there's like definite issues why it's so cheap.
Yeah.
And it is cheap because there's a lot of things to take care of.
Yeah.
You know, we have to have water, and we have to secure the living room, and we have to have, you know, if it gets too cold, we're going to have to have some other heat source or something.
How cold does it get down there in Kentucky? I mean,
well, that's the thing. It's not that bad for that long. That's, you know, like, I don't know. It's been in the 30s so far.
Yeah, so it gets down in the 30s, which is still pretty cold, you know. Need some kind of heat.
Especially if whatever heat exists isn't enough.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe I'll just work and sleep in the studio.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you can always, like, buy the electric heaters, but that brings your electric bill up, but...
Yeah, and we don't want to start the house on fire or something. It's plenty of trees. We'll have a barbecue outside or something going.
Yeah, I mean, you could find a stove and, you know, stick it in there, and then you could do that, but that's a pain. Then you got to cut wood all the time.
Yeah, no, I don't know.
I wonder what the deal is with the furnace. If they're saying it has a furnace, you'd think that it would be, you know.
Well, maybe, I don't know. It's some sort of heat source.
Yeah.
To just rattle off a list of things and we're going to see it. We're going to go Thursday for reviewing, which is what?
Yeah.
Tomorrow? What's today?
Today's Tuesday.
Yeah, 2 days from now. There's so much going on, so I have to keep track of it.
Yeah.
I don't know, you know. I still love the house, you know. You wouldn't know It's kind of, it was a trailer.
Is it sitting on a foundation, or is it actually just fill up on wheels or something, or blocks?
It looks like it's on a probably foundation. Like,
yes.
There's a door on the side of the house. It's a crawl space, so I didn't.
Yeah, it's probably sitting on something, yeah, like blocks or something. Or, I mean, it's probably on a little block foundation, which is good. Yeah, I don't know. It doesn't sound that bad. You guys could get in there and work with it.
Yeah.
And so, I bet, like, if it's got a well, then it's like, I bet you're okay for water, unless the well is just bad or something. You know? We had a well up in the mountains, but it was, like, too shallow, so it would only really run good, like, in the spring. Got a phone call, Peter. He's not home. I don't know. In that place, too, it was like the, you know, the heat was not that great either, and, like, you know, we kept, like, the whole place warm in the winter with, like, a wood stove, and I had to cut wood all year to freaking build up the supply, so that was kind of a bitch. You can make anything work if you want to.
Yeah, I think we'll
Pete's at the call center right now.
We'll figure out a heating system that doesn't involve extra work.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, obviously I could tell why.
Why it's going for cheap. Yeah.
Picked up, and it's going cheap, and, you know, there's work involved. But, like I said, you know, we know a couple of people who know their stuff, and I'm not afraid to do some work. Oh, at least it wants my attention. Okay, hold on.
Yeah, I mean, you know, like, here in Boulder, I don't know if you got this out in Kentucky, but, like, there's places that people like to, you know, like, when we tear out stuff, you just drop it off, and it's kind of like almost like a recycle place, but it's all for building materials. And you could go there and, you know, pick up, like, old cabinets and stuff for, like, super cheap, you know, like $20 for, you know, a bunch of cabinets that you could put in a kitchen that you just didn't really care about, you know. And, so you could probably get your kitchen working, but what?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Lisa called me. I'm gonna have to get going. I have to run to the bank and I'm gonna have to pay off.
Okay,
all
right.
All our bills and all that. But yeah, we know there's I forget what she called it. There's ways to get like free. A bunch of like free furniture and cabinets and whatnot. We can just make shift the kitchen. I don't care. She don't care. Just as long as it's functioning.
Yeah.
And it won't cost us a lot. They won't be pretty, but you know, big deal. At least we'll have a giant house. but yeah, I'm gonna have to run. I'll be back tomorrow. Thanks for coming on, Jay, and thanks for having me, as always, Jeff, and yeah, I'm sure I'll have stuff to talk about.
Tune in for the continuation of the story of the
Let me start a GoFundMe soon. Alright, guys, have fun.
Alright, good luck, Pete.
Alright, thanks.
But. Wow, that guy's got a lot on his plate right now.
Yeah, I know. He's taking it in a pretty good stride, though, I gotta admit.
Yeah.
You got any cats?
No, I'm deathly allergic to cats.
Yeah. Oh, that sucks.
Yeah, you know, the great thing is, like, my mother, she's one of those crazy cat ladies. She's got three of them.
Oh, okay.
So, it's good and bad. Like, I don't really have to go visit her that often just because I can't breathe every time I walk into her house. But
Yeah,
I just, you know, even if I wasn't allergic to cats, I don't think I'd like cats anyways.
Yeah.
No, I got a dog. I got a boxer. I love dogs. I certainly have no love for cats.
Hmm.
Well, yeah. You got a dog. You know, like they just want to hang out and have fun. And it seems like with a cat, they can only be bothered with you when they're hungry.
No, I know exactly what you're talking about, and that's kind of how I look at it. But you know, I don't really say it in front of Peter much, but. When you said your mom was a crazy cat lady, I was expecting like 30 cats or something, because my mom is actually a crazy dog and cat lady, and I think she's got like 27 animals all together over there.
You can't be serious, really?
I'm 100% serious.
Wow, okay.
Yeah.
She just
carried away, and dogs and cats, she got carried away with once, and now she's got all these damn things.
That, wow, like, you figured they must take over the whole house, eh?
Oh, yeah, they do. She's got, like, you know, big house, but then, you know, half of them are downstairs, and then she's got the ones she really likes upstairs, but they're just, you know, tons of dogs everywhere. I don't know. That's my mom for you.
I know what you're saying, yeah.
I remember when I was painting, I had, you know, I was down there one time working a job, because she lives, like, way down south, and I got this job, like, way down there, so I was like, I'll go down there and I'll paint that house, and then I had the two people working for me up here, and, I was like, you know, you guys finish up this house and I'll be back, you know what I mean?
Yes.
And so they finished up their stuff, and then I was still down there trying to get this house done, and I was like, well, if you guys want to come down, you know, for a couple days, because I can't come back and set anything up right now, you can just come down here and help me, and we could all stay at my mom's house and, you know, have a fun time or whatever. And so they did. And, like, they come up to the house, and, like, all the dogs are raising hell. Oh, shit, you know? Yes. And, like, it's, like, the people I worked for me, it was, like, this guy, Derek, and his girlfriend at the time. And so they're, like, how many dogs has your mom got? It sounds like she's got, like, you know, five or six or, you know, something like that. And I just had to laugh, and I'm, like, well, it's not quite that. And then, like, you know, Janelle's, like, well, it sounds like it. I'm nice. Like, no, it's way worse than what you think. That's just so funny. Yeah, because nobody's got that many dogs.
Not that I know. No.
And then, you know, like, she did this, like, a while ago, and some of them started to kind of croak and get old, and I was like, oh, good, finally they're going away, you know, and then she ended up getting more of them, so. I don't know.
Yeah, see, my mom's like that, too. Like, every cat, like, she's got three now.
Yeah.
But if one of them were to die tomorrow, she would get another cat the same day.
Yeah. Yeah.
Did you know, she'll call me up. Yeah, like, she'll call me up and be like, oh, you know, Whistler isn't feeling good, and I think I'm going to have him put down, and... You know, I'm not saying anything, but I got a little grin on my face because I'm thinking, okay, that's one less cat that I have to deal with every time I go see you.
Yeah.
And then I'll go to her place and visit her, and she's like, oh, look, here's my new baby. Oh, God, Mom, come on.
Yeah.
And it's funny, too, because I'll come over and visit her, and I'll be there for, I don't know, maybe half an hour is about all I can take, and then I look at her and say, you know, I gotta go, I can't breathe.
Oh, wow.
And she'll get all upset with me, like, oh, you don't come visit me enough, and you never stay. I'm like, well, I'm allergic to your cats.
Yeah, that's kind of a drag. I painted with a guy who was allergic to cats, too, and man, it's like of all the jobs to do when you're allergic to cats, because they're going into everybody's homes, and then so often you're painting a house that had cats in it, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And people move, and it's just like, ugh, he was always having trouble.
Yeah, people are worried. Like, I think half the thing, too, is that people, like, when you say you're allergic to cats, they don't really understand, like, how bad it can be.
Yeah.
They're like, oh, just take a Benadryl, you'll be fine. It's like, no, that's not going to help. Like, I can't breathe.
Yeah. Is it
but
just...
Anyways, I'm not trying to piss off anybody with cats.
Yeah. You can piss off the whole internet, but
yeah, people are logging off
right now. No, I'm kidding. It's are you just like, is it just cats that you're allergic to, or are you like one of those people who are allergic to a lot of things?
I mean, when I was a kid, I was really bad. I had to go get a the shot in the arm at the doctor every week for my allergies. And yeah, because for a while, like, when I was first born, up until I was about a teenager, I couldn't even drink milk. I was allergic to that, too.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that sucked, because I had to drink goat's milk. And I don't know if anybody out there has ever had goat's milk, but that is the most god-awful stuff I have ever tasted in my life. But thankfully, like, that allergy kind of went away after... Like, I think I was about 16, and finally I had that under control. But
yeah.
Yeah, I was one of those weird kids. Like, I was literally allergic to everything.
Yeah.
But for the most part now, I'm pretty cool. It's just cats. I don't know what it is with cats. I've never gotten over it. If anything, I think that's actually got worse.
Hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it's funny you mention goats, because that's my mom. Speaking of my mom, that's one of her other hobbies is milking goats. She's got, like, a bunch of goats around her place.
Oh, yeah?
You probably couldn't even, like, survive at my mom's house, really.
It doesn't sound like it, no. It'd be, like, my personal hell.
Yeah. But she she's all about that damn goat milk, and, it tastes different. It just tastes way different, and...
Oh, you're being way too nice, man. It doesn't taste different. It tastes god-awful.
Yeah. I can't really... I mean, it's like it's funny, because like at one point I was like, I went over to her house one time, and I'm just like, I got to get over this goat milk thing. And, you know, it's just probably all in my head, and I'm gonna drink a glass of this dang goat milk and just get over with... You know what I mean? I mean, I got some, and I put some, like, chocolate in there. I figured, like, I'll make some goat chocolate milk. It'll be great. I just couldn't even get through the glass. It just, there's something really weird to taste, you know.
Yeah, that stuff is horrible.
My brother always says it tastes like a goat smells, so. It's horrible, but I guess, you know, a good chunk of the world drinks it. But.
Yeah, because, I mean, I know a few people, like, they just buy it because they like it, and I'm looking at them thinking, God, you're out of your mind, dude.
Yeah. Because, my mom, you know, she milks those goats and sells the milk, and she gets, like, a big price for it because all these, you know, kind of healthy eaters and granola head type people around here just want that natural milk and natural goat's milk, and they go crazy over that stuff.
Yeah, like, I don't get it, but... Yeah, that was the thing that always kind of I found weird when I was a kid, like, because I know my dad would take, we had to go to this health food store to buy it, and I remember he would always get mad because he'd pick up a, you know, like a liter carton of this goat's milk, and he'd get all pissed off. He's like, I don't understand why I have to pay twice the amount of money for something that tastes like shit.
Yeah.
And he'd be looking at me and like, I'm sorry, Dad. I don't want to be allergic to milk.
Yeah, my brother, he's got like some cattle and he does like the, I mean, they're both into the raw milk thing, which is, you can't get that in grocery stores, you know?
No, like, isn't that illegal to sell or something like that?
Yeah, it is. It's illegal to sell it unless there's a way around it, and they both do it. Whereas, like, the people who buy, like, the raw milk from my brother and my mom, they, like, they have to, like, kind of, like, it's almost like signing up for, like, a subscription. It's like they agree to, like, buy part of the cow, you know what I mean, or, like, rent part of the goat, you know what I mean? So that, okay, like, yeah. It's like they're milking their own goat because they've signed this paper that says that they're, you know, because it's not illegal to drink it, it's just illegal to, like, sell it. So by doing that, then, you know, then they can get it. And so that's what everybody does, you know. They just figure out, like, how much milk they're going to get over, like, the space of, like, a couple months, and then they sign a thing for that. But it's, like, it is big business here, you know. Like, Boulder's, like, you know, healthy city type thing and all that stuff. And
yeah.
They're going crazy for that kind of stuff around here.
Well, I mean, I like to eat well, but I'm certainly not going to milk a cow into a bucket and just start drinking it down. Wow, that's taking it to a whole new level.
Oh, that's funny. Well, where do you think that milk comes from?
Well, I know where it comes from, but, you know, at least it's, like, they pasteurize it and whatnot. Right. Like, literally, just imagine this, like, just putting a glass under a cow, milking it, and drinking it. Like, oh.
I grew up on a farm, so it's like, you know, my dad would bring the bucket in, my mom would pour it into the thing, and we'd basically pour it on our cereal, so pretty much done.
Oh, wow. Well, yeah, I guess you were born into it, so you could handle it. You know, I'm a city boy. I'm really a city boy, and that would just gross me out.
I was watching some reality show where they were doing that. They were actually milking goats, though. And they were like, okay, let's have a taste of the milk. And all the girls were, like, spitting it out and stuff. And, oh, my God, it's so horrible. You know? It's funny.
Yeah, well. Yeah, so that piece you're working on there, that's looking really good, man.
Oh, thanks, dude.
Actually, you got quite a bit done since I caught the show from yesterday. I was watching it later on. You got quite a bit done on it, eh?
Yeah, I worked on it a little last night, too. So, want to get it out. It's like a commission I sold off eBay. I like to get those done and quickly and delivered so I don't have any kind of trouble, because a lot of times I don't know those people that well, you know?
Yeah, I hear you.
So, exactly. It's funny, it's like, that's that part of my thing. I usually just put everybody in a line, I try to just go down the line, but that's one situation where if somebody starts, like, being a squeaky wheel, I'll just jump them right to the front and get them out of there, because, I don't know, just never know what's going to happen on there, you know, on eBay.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I know what you're saying, like, if somebody leaves you bad feedback, like, it's a real pain, eh?
Oh, yeah, it can really screw you up, so you don't want that happening. Yeah, like, at one point I got into trouble with this one lady, and it wasn't my fault, really, and I just felt like she was, you know, kind of just a problem customer. And anyway, like, eBay ended up siding with me. I'm sure I've told the story on the show somewhere, and I thought, oh, okay, well, that's fine, and the whole thing went away. But then it was, like, later when they reviewed my account, they kind of do a review on your account every now and then, and it was like, because I had, like, a certain amount of cases, like, opened against me, even though they were shut. I got, like, these limitations put on my account, and they were, like, holding my money for, like, 20 days and all this bullshit. And it was a real pain in the ass till that went away again, you know? And I was kind of like, you know, I didn't really do anything wrong. But it's hard to, you know, it's eBay, it's the internet. They don't, you can't really talk to anybody, so.
Yeah, that's the sad part of it. You can't argue with them.
Yeah, exactly. So.
How's, just out of curiosity, how are, because I know you said you jumped on Amazon. How's that working out for you?
Amazon sells pretty well. I haven't had much luck with originals, but I think it's just because I haven't really, you know, everything pretty much sells off eBay, so I'll stick one up on Amazon, and it'll be there like a week, and then I'll take it back down because it sells on eBay. So
yeah.
I think if you had art to just leave up there for a while, because I think that Amazon doesn't work quite like eBay. You know, eBay immediately kind of puts it out in front of people, and they find it. But I think Amazon, it's really got to sit there for a little while to get into the search and stuff. So, but yeah, for prints, it actually worked real well. I kind of took a lot of them down once I had my problems with my store. But I've got a few more up there again, and they're selling. So, not as good as eBay, though. But I don't know. I haven't pushed it as hard either. So, you thinking about doing it?
eBay? No,
I meant Amazon.
Well, I was kind of curious about it. Like, I mean, I finally got a store open on my side. I did get a store envy thing for it, and like I've sold a couple of pieces off it. Like, for the most part, I really don't have like a lot of original stuff usually kicking around to sell. But
yeah,
actually, I was kind of surprised because I opened up the store Envy, and then I hopped on Instagram and said, you know, just had a post saying, hey, my store's open, and 2 hours later, the piece was sold.
Goddamn Instagram.
I know you hate it, but, man, you really got to get on it. Seriously, dude.
Well, I hate it because I hear stories like this, and every time I go there, and I get my ass handed to me, so I just got to, like, bear down and muscle my way through this and get it working.
Yeah, because
it's really that good, huh?
Oh, it's unbelievable, man. It really is. Like, once you get to, like, a certain amount of followers, like, it won't be immediate. But
yeah.
But yeah, it's great. Like, I mean, anything I do pretty much now, like I have enough of a following, like, anything I post, like, I guarantee you today I'll take a picture of this later on once it starts to actually look like something. Yeah. I'll put it up, and somebody's going to message me saying, hey, man, how much? I want to buy it.
Jeez.
Like,
well,
it's
I like the
fun.
Sound of that, that's for sure.
Yeah, because you get this direct messaging thing, and actually, I've had a couple of guys, like, I'll put up a piece, and they'll start leaving posts on that picture saying, please check your DM, I sent you a message. So I'll check that, and you know, I want to buy it, how much? And I'll message him back and say, you know what, I'm sorry, but it's already sold. And they'll get all pissed off, like, God damn it, I can't believe that I didn't get it this time, and they're getting all mad. And it does, it makes you laugh. You're thinking, wow, this is insane.
That's pretty awesome. I've had people do that on eBay, though, where it's like, I'll post a thing, and they'll just be like, why didn't you message me? You know?
Yeah. Yeah, the people are weird, too, you know, because they're like, oh, well, I really wanted it, and I'll send them a message saying, well, I'll make you another one. It won't be exactly the same, obviously, but I'll do a piece for you. And they're like, well, how long's that going to take? Like, they get all bent out of shape because, you know, like, they wanted it, like, literally right now.
Yeah. Yeah, that's funny. Yeah, that's cool that you're selling a bunch of stuff on there.
Yeah, but I mean, like you said, your wife has one of those Kindle things, right?
She does. She's actually got a phone now, too. It's not an iPhone, but it's like one of those Samsung or something like that.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I got. I just got a Samsung Galaxy or something like that.
That might be the same one. Yeah, so I was thinking I could get on there and try to do it there. Because I've tried on the internet, you know, to just... The thing is, she's always got her phone, so I got to kind of... You gotta grab it, figure out how to turn that thing on.
Yeah, well, I'm sure it's one of those things, you know, even if, like, she could do it for you, you know? Like.
Yeah. Well, I thought that, too. Maybe I could just email her the photos or something. Put them up, babe. Because she used to list, like, my auctions on eBay and stuff, so she's actually pretty good at doing stuff like that. But not my originals, but she handled all the print stuff, which was really nice. I can't convince her to do that anymore, though.
Yeah, like if you ever do jump on it, you know, like, I'm more than happy to give you a couple of pointers and how to make it work.
Yeah, definitely. I'll take you up on that. I gotta run my hairbrush for 1 second, so.
Yeah, go for it.
Yeah, I guess you don't ever use a hair dryer, huh? Because you don't ever touch the piece. It's all airbrush, or mostly airbrush, huh?
Well, yeah, when I'm working on metal, it's 100% airbrush. Yeah, I don't use a hair dryer. I do have a... like, when I got the piece done, I got a heat gun that'll go over it for a few minutes with, just to make sure that the paint's cured before I get it clear-coated.
Right, yeah. Which I'm using.
I mean, I am using acrylics, just like you, so if that acrylic isn't dry and you clear it, you're going to have a really bad chemical reaction. So.
Yeah. That's interesting. So you just use a normal old acrylics on even, like, metal, like the car body parts, and then the clear coat is just kind of what keeps it on there?
Yeah, I mean, that's law here in Canada. It was about...
Oh.
When did they do that? I think it was 2000... It was January 1st, 2006, the law came into effect. All solvents are banned. Like, you can still use a, like, self-etching primer, and you can use urethane clear coats, but they have to comply to the government laws. Like, they can only have so much of a percentage of VOCs in them. I don't know what it is off the top of my head, but all the base coats, like the actual paints, they're all waterborne paints now.
Wow.
And it's, like, don't get me wrong, I love solvents. Like, if I could go back to solvent tomorrow, I would in a heartbeat. I'm not a big fan of acrylics.
Really?
Like, I mean, you know, you make it work because you don't have a choice, but definitely solvents are so much better. Like, you never get, like, you know how it is with an airbrush. Like, you get tip dry and all that with the acrylics. With solvents, that doesn't happen.
Yeah. Yeah. I've never tried to paint with any kind of, like, you know, I guess you're probably not using oil paint, but it's like anything like that with an airbrush anyway. I've always been, like, either acrylics or gouache. That's about it, all I've ever done with it.
Yeah, I messed around with gouache years ago, like when I was a kid. That's kind of a tricky thing to use.
Yeah. Because it always, you know, it's never, like, acrylics will dry out completely and the water won't wake it back up, and gouache will always wake back up when you put water back on it.
Yeah. So. Yeah, I couldn't even imagine airbrushing with it.
It actually works pretty well, but, you know, it's the same thing. You know, you start spraying over it and you get too wet, it starts kind of blending with the layer below it and stuff, so.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, because even with
I don't remember who got me going on that.
Yeah, because even with the paints I use here, like, they're all acrylics, but to reduce them, they're all thinned with alcohol so that it actually makes them dry, like, 10 times harder.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's interesting. What kind of acrylics do you use? Just, like, the normal, like, golden acrylics and stuff, or are you getting some kind of different kind, or...?
Well, right now I'm using mainly FW acrylic ink, actually.
Is that, like, the stuff that's specifically for airbrush, then? The little tubes or whatever? Or the little bottles?
Yeah. I don't think they're made for airbrushing, you know, per se, but they work really well.
Yeah.
Because all the paint, like the automotive paint companies, like I used to use PPG pretty much exclusively, and they came out with their waterborne line, and holy God, this stuff is like putting mud through a straw.
Really?
Yeah, and it's got this really, I don't know what the hell they're putting in their paints for pigments, but like, take for example the black, when you mix the black and it's actually green.
Oh, weird.
Yeah, you spray it, and when it goes on wet, it's green, and as it dries, it turns black.
Oh, but, my God. You know,
imagine trying to do artwork with that.
Yeah. Yeah,
you know, even if I'm trying to mix up a gray color, you're looking at it, you're like, okay, that kind of looks like pea soup green. Maybe that'll dry gray, you know?
Yeah, that almost just sounds impossible.
Yeah, like I know, like all the painters around here, like anybody in the industry, like they're just up in arms. They, you know, it's been what, 7 years now we've been using it, and everybody just hates it.
Yeah. Yeah. That's wild.
Yeah, because I know the guy, Roger, the guy that does all my body work, he's, like, before that law came into effect, I think he bought about 100 gallons of certain colors. Honest to God, I'm not kidding.
Yeah.
He still has black from, you know, 6 years ago, and you can probably keep going for another couple of years. But
yeah.
Because PPG came into his shop, and they gave him a whole new mixing system with all the waterborne paints, and still to this day, like, I'll be in the studio airbrushing, right, and every now and then you can just hear him howling at the top of his lungs, and I always start laughing. I'm like, well, I guess you had to use the water base today.
Yeah. Yeah, that's funny. Yeah, I didn't know about all that, you know, as far as art goes, just because I guess I already use acrylics and I just kind of buy what's at the art store. But I kind of knew about some of that stuff because of painting houses. And, you know, they changed a lot of those laws, too. And, yeah. You know, it's kind of the same thing. But
yeah, it's slowly, apparently, like in the States, I think they were aiming for 20, I think it's 2020, they want to have it outlawed in the States, too.
Yeah.
Because what is it? Already, I mean, California, yeah. It's outlawed. I think they have to use all waterborne in California right now.
I think you might be right, or that's going into effect pretty soon or something.
Yeah. The beauty of that is, though, like, because all the manufacturers, they're all based out of the States, so when it becomes mandatory that the U.S. has to do it, that's when I think they're actually going to improve on the formula and make it work better.
That makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah, because it's kind of fun. Like, even like with the Harley dealers down here, because all the Harleys, when they get the factory paint, that's all done in the States, and then it gets shipped to Canada. So if there's a bike with damage on it, like, not that I do repair work, but my body guy does, like, certain colors, like, say it's a Sunglow orange, that's a really popular Harley color, yeah. He'll go to PPG and say, okay, I need the code for this, and they'll say, well, it's only available in solvent, and we can't ship it to Canada, so good luck.
Man. Yeah.
And that's where you got to get really creative mixing these watercolors to make it match. And, you know, for the most part, it's not even 100% match. You just blend it out enough that you can't really notice it, you know?
Really? Yeah.
Yeah, like, I mean, honestly, for the last couple of years here in Canada, the whole paint industry has just been a mess. It really has.
Yeah. Yeah, that sounds like a real pain in the ass. The only thing is, like, where I was, like, a painter, in some ways I kind of liked it a little bit, you know, the restrictions, because I felt like, you know, I always hated breathing the stuff, you know what I mean? So, like, once they started kind of, like, restricting on the lacquers and stuff, it was kind of nice, because then I had an excuse to not have to breathe it, because I couldn't get it, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, that is the one bonus. Like, I don't feel like I'm going to hack up a lung every day anymore, but...
Yeah.
But, I mean, other than that, I really have nothing good to say about the stuff.
Yeah. Do you ever wear a respirator or anything, like, where you do so much airbrushing?
Oh, yeah, like, right now I'm just doing little stuff, but if I open it up, I got this bad boy that I put on.
Oh, okay, yeah. Because I got a mask too. When I'm really spraying a lot, I'll actually get it out. And I never used to before I ever was like a house painter, but yeah. I kind of feel it a little bit now. I think just because I sprayed too much of that shit when I was painting houses, you know.
Yeah, like I got the respirator, and I do have an exhaust system. I don't turn it on when I'm on camera because it's really loud.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, if anything, you know, maybe you should try that out sometime when you're using the airbrush. Try thinning your paint out with alcohol instead of water.
Yeah, I might give that a shot. Never heard of that.
Yeah, because like I say, it'll dry a lot quicker and harder, but it also it kind of melts the pigment a little bit, so it sprays a little smoother.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I noticed that something about your airbrush work that, like, you know, I don't want to go all gushing on you, but, you know, I'm a fan. But I noticed, like, with your airbrush compared to, like, a lot of the stuff I've seen, you know, like, around the Artcasters and just different places, there seems to be, like, a glow that you get, and it almost looks like what you're saying, like, smoother or something. I was thinking about, like, that one piece you did with, like, the professional. I can't remember his name.
Leon.
Yeah. Man, that portrait just came out just so nice. And just, you know, it's like, I don't know. I don't usually see art where I'm like, oh, wow, that's like, I mean, it's neat. You know, like when you see stuff, like, it makes you almost kind of want to, like, you're like, that's a level, you know, where I want to get to sometimes. You know what I mean? You don't see that much as you paint. And then that piece almost kind of did it for me. I'm like, that's damn good. You know what I mean?
Thanks, man. Appreciate it.
It's all right. I can see, like, why people are hitting up your Instagram and, you know, wanting this kind of stuff. Because, I'm not seeing that kind of quality around eBay and stuff. You know what I mean? With some of these other fan art guys. But I'll shut up. I don't know how that is. Like, when people go off on that, it's just like, you know, you kind of laugh, like, well, what can I say? I don't know. You know, what do I have? But
yeah, well, I know, like, every time you got a piece up, like, you post a link saying you got a piece up on eBay, I always go check it out. And you know, you, at the bottom of the page, it'll say what other people are looking at that's kind of related to it.
Yeah.
And there is a lot of good art on eBay. There's a lot of really good artists on eBay.
Yeah, there is. It's just, I wish that, you know, eBay was like, I mean, it works for me, I think, just because it's like, I started with it, I've gotten good at it. But, you know, it's just, I mean, it is, you know, it's still like the online flea market. I mean, it's just, you know, bargain hunters, really.
Yeah.
You end up getting, you know, you get clients out of that who are really good clients, and they come back again and again, but, you know, you also are just, it's always a race to the bottom on that damn site, you know. But, you know, it's also like, you know, like right now, it's just like a lot of times I just need to make money, so, you know. I just need to get something sold sometimes, not so much like, you know, hold out for the great prices.
Yeah.
So, in that sense, I think it works great, but I don't know. Is it the answer to, like, selling art? I don't know about that. You ever done any of it on eBay? Are you ever going to... I mean, you probably just don't need to, actually. You've got, like, a whole business going, so...
Yeah, like, that's kind of the thing. Like, I do my own, like, personal work, but it... Not enough. Like, I mean, 9 times out of 10, if I do something, I can have it sold before it's even finished, so...
Right.
And, I mean, other than that, I got, like, a gigantic waiting list to get all these bikes done, so...
Yeah.
In that sense, I don't really have a big need for it, but...
Yeah.
It's not to say I don't want to try it. I probably will, just for kicks at some point, just to see how it works.
Yeah. Well, I've seen some guys, you know, if you got, like, a following, and then they'll go on eBay, and, I mean, they will bring in, like, those, huge prices because I get a couple, you know, because that's like the beauty of eBay. You get like a couple people who want that thing that have some cash in their pocket, and that can go as far as it wants, you know?
Yeah.
So.
Well, I mean, like, yeah, like, I know, like, your pieces, they seem to sell for a pretty decent price. Like, you're definitely doing well for yourself on there.
They go for okay, yeah.
And there's another guy, like, I'm still kind of getting familiar with the whole Artcasters thing on Facebook, but...
Yeah.
I'm friends with a guy on there now. You obviously know him. What's his name? Victor...
Oh, Gardino or something like that? Or
yeah, something like that, yeah. He put up a couple links to his eBay stuff, and I was checking that out. And, you know, you can click on their ratings and whatnot, and... Like, that guy seems to be selling a ton of work on there.
I know. He does, like, a lot of Vampire Babes and stuff like that. And he did. Yeah. He gets, like, really good prices. I haven't known him for that long, but, yeah, I was noticing that the other day. Like, he's really rocking the sales on there, so.
Yeah, because, I mean, you know, I was looking at all his prints, and, you know, they're going for a decent buck, but then... When you're looking at his feedback, like the amount of originals, and you can see what they're selling for, it's pretty impressive.
Yeah.
I mean, the guy does really nice work. Like, I'll give him that. Like, beautiful paintings.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's, like, the thing. You got to do good work. That's just, like, the given. But I think, too, like, you know, I mean, that's one thing nice about commissions, because the more commissions you get, you know, it's like... Then you don't need eBay as much, and it's like that's always the best time to go on there. It's like when you don't need to sell something because you can put it at a higher price, and you can just be like just sit on it and wait. Yeah. And inevitably, you'll get somebody, but it's harder to do that when you're like I got 3 days and I got to get rid of this thing. You know what I mean? And whoever's coming is coming, and they're gonna get it. You know? I think he does sell a lot of, like, buy-it-nows on there. I don't know if he does a lot of auctions, but I might be wrong.
Well, from what I saw, he had the buy-it-now and with the...
That's the offer.
Yeah.
This is a good way. Then you get to talking to somebody.
So, I mean, like, eBay aside... Are you getting a lot of commissions just off your site?
I get them off of there. I mean, I don't know. I've been auctioning commissions on eBay. That's where my big load has come from lately. But I definitely have, like, you know, the guys just going to my site and buying them right now. So it's always, like, that kind of thing, you know, that's, like, somebody I know in general. You know, it's just like eBay is where they discover me, and then eventually they get over there, and then they buy stuff just straight from me, which is the way you want it to happen. And that's pretty much what happened with the sketch cards, too, you know. Eventually I just wasn't hardly on eBay at all, just because, you know, all I would do is just do commissions for people. So. Anyway, what time is it going to be? It's actually about 10:30. I wonder if we should wrap it up.
Yeah, totally up to you. I'm fine with that.
Okay. So I usually go for 2 hours. So anyway, I'll see you guys tomorrow. Jay, do you want to say your website?
Airheadscustom.com. Airheads with a Z. That's where you can find me.
Go there and get some cool art. Get your bike painted. And I'm Jeff Lafferty from JeffLafferty.net. See you guys.
Yep.